Ladies and gentlemen, welcome onto stage, Erin and a bunch of Minecraft developers.
Hello, Minecon 2015! Hello! How are you guys doing today? Are you having a good day so far? Yeah? Good. Okay, thank you for coming along to our Minecraft New Features panel. I'm here with a bunch of the Minecraft developers. We have Daniel and Tommaso. They work on Pocket Edition. We've got Yetis down there, and Nathan work on all versions of Minecraft pretty much. Now, in traditional Mojang style, we have a folder full of stuff, which we're going to pick from and discuss in some kind of logical order. That's the idea, yes?
Absolutely.
Cool. So we thought we'd kick it off super early with something really exciting. Nathan, let's talk about dragons.
Dragons, yes. You like dragons?
Absolutely.
Do you guys like dragons? I don't think they like dragons. Let's skip the dragons.
Let's skip the dragons. No, actually, come on now. Dragons. One dragon in particular.
The Ender Dragon. What would you like to know about the Ender Dragon?
Well, I've heard on the grapevine that we are making some changes to the way that the Ender Dragon fight might happen at the end of the game.
It's no secret, I'm pretty sure everyone in this audience would agree, the Ender Dragon fight right now in PC Edition is not a fight. It is, you go to the end, you break a few blocks, and then you hit him over the head a couple of times. Is that a fight? I don't think so. So, I've taken a lot of inspiration from Console Edition, and I'm sure we've got a lot of Console Edition fans in the audience who know what that fight's like. And right now, the state of the dragon is that it is exactly like the Console Edition, but better. So, you go in there, the pillars are arranged, there's a set amount of pillars now. They're arranged in a very specific fashion. I've got a video of this, actually, which I can show while I explain it.
Can we get this on screen, please?
It could be that one, let's find out. Alright, so you've got these pillars arranged in a circular fashion. They're all different heights, and the really tall ones have cages, so you can't just shoot them with a bow, because that's boring. I want you to go up there and die. The Ender Dragon himself flies around, he's got these different maneuvers, sometimes he perches down on top of the Ender Podium in the middle. Oh no! Spoilers! Don't look! We are professionals,
it's the playlist.
Yeah. I don't think that's the first time that's going to happen in the next hour, so prepare yourselves.
Can we take our computer off the screen?
Great.
Okay, carry on, Nathan,
So the Ender Dragon himself will fly around, he protects the pillars, depending on how far you progress against the fight, you'll either fly into pillars, he'll stop you from actively going up there and destroying them. And the further along you get, he'll actually come down and fight you on top of the Ender Podium. He's got these fire breath, and he will attack anyone he comes close, even Enderman, if they try to come too close to him. So it's a much more involved fight now. It is not just break a block, hit the dragon.
But like, will this fight only ever happen once in your Minecraft playthrough?
That's a good question. Oh, I think we can...
We can bring back the screen now. We have fixed the problem.
The technical fault.
Yeah. All right, great. Professionals, don't worry. So, a lot of people right now have already defeated the dragon, and they're not obviously going to get to see the fight if we didn't already pay attention to that fight. So what I have done is that I'm going to make it so the dragon respawns on every world right now, if you choose to, and that can happen as many times as you want. You can fight the dragon over and over again, and then benefit to that. You can respawn the dragon using a very special technique. These ender crystals right now you see on the screen, which heal the dragon when he flies past, like that beam right there, you can craft a version of these. And if you place them on the pillars, the dragon will respawn. And if he respawns, I'm afraid you won't get another egg, sadly, but you will get some other different ingredients, specifically his breath, but I won't go too much in detail on that.
That sounds awesome. Thanks, Nate. That sounds super cool. Okay, so that was quite exciting to start us off. I think that went pretty well. Yes. Let's talk about an area in Minecraft, an exciting area, and how you might have expanded upon it. Let's do that.
Yeah, this is connected to the Ender Dragon fight. You all know that once you defeat the Ender Dragon, there's not much to do in the end. So we wanted to expand the end and make it infinite, like the other dimensions. So how that's going to work, I'm not going to explain everything, but essentially, in addition to the middle island, there will be many, many, many islands. And there will be more things to find on these islands, so we can, let's see here, I have a... okay, in order to reach these islands, you will still have to defeat the Ender Dragon, and it will give you a new kind of portal. Do you know where it is?
It should be in my folder. The new thing has been called the End Gateway, because otherwise we already called the End Portal, and we were internally referring it to the End Portal, which is really weird. So the End Gateway, there we go.
Okay, can put this screen on screen.
It might be very difficult to see because it's black, and we didn't think that through with the projector, but it is essentially the end portal, a full solid block inside the structure. And you'll notice it's only one block tall. Maybe you can figure out what to do with that.
So, I'm gonna show you... show you another clip. Let's go. How do I do?
Talk amongst yourselves as we locate the files.
So I guess I can show this. Okay. Yeah, so I recorded this with a potato.
That's a massive spoiler for the late part of the presentation, yes.
When you reach these other islands, you will find this curious new environment, and we've added a new dungeon, which currently goes under the name of the End City. That's the programmer name, and they have a tendency to speak, but you can see it's a teaser. I think the video shows more than I can say.
That looks like a kind of spooky place with the super tall structures. What is that?
I'm going to show you in one moment. You can repeat it once more so you can have a second chance to see. So when I was working on this, I wanted when we add things in the different dimension, we want to stay on that dimension. So when I created this, I didn't want to use any stone or anything that come from the overworld or no netherrack or anything like that. So I wanted to create new blocks to build this with. And in the end, the color scheme is more or less yellow, purple, and black. So I added these new purple blocks and that little creature. And whenever we add new blocks, we want them to be infinite. So you can see these plant things that I walk around here. They are currently called chorus plants. And they can be farmed for fruit, which in turn can be used for creating more of these purple blocks. So I'm gonna show this here.
I love that.
So I'm collecting a bunch of forest food.
Thank you.
So much enthusiasm for the forest food. It was immediately clapping.
I'm sure everyone will agree, the behind-the-wall effects are just so much fun.
So, in order to replant this stuff, you will need to do a special technique. Because the chorus root itself cannot be replanted. But you actually need to reach for the flowers that are in the top. But I will let you explore this on your own when you get a chance to try the first 1.9 snapshot that will be released very soon.
Cool. Thanks, Jens.
Yeah, that sounds great. So you want to see more of that? Creature?
Yeah. Let's talk about that strange creature which launched a odd projectile at you. What is going on?
How do I move this window?
Stop it. That just looks like a block, Jens. That's just a block, that's not a creature.
No?
Okay.
So, when I created this new dungeons, I wanted to add a new hostile mob. So, I was thinking about different ideas, and one I settled on was actually I wanted to create a kind of complicated lock mob that would camouflage itself in the environment. So, my idea was that it would attach to blocks and take the texture of the block it was sitting on. I also have a kind of complex model. It had a lot of details and stuff. But while I was developing it, I realized that maybe I was overcomplicating things. It also turned out to be very challenging to do the texture copying thing in the current code base. Maybe we can do it in the future, so maybe for a new mod. So I decided to simplify it. This block you're looking at now, it's called the Shulker. And we invented that name. It's essentially a shell lurker in one word.
Programmers are great at naming things.
And it kind of can. It will open up and shoot these projectiles that you could see in the other clip. And oops. Go away. And because they are like a block mob, I wanted the projectiles to also follow more or less the block world of Minecraft. So you can see they take kind of curious paths towards the targets. And in this particular case, I used a command to put one of the shulkers in a team. So they will become hostile to other teams. You can actually use that in custom maps to have shulkers that are part of one player team but not the other. And you can use them as defense mobs. I'm sure people will find out fun things to do that.
What happens if I get hit by a shulker's projectile?
Well, first of all, you take damage, supposedly, right?
Yeah, okay.
But I also wanted that to make it to be a more interesting in the sense that this end city stay are very vertical, and in the end, there's a lot of these islands that are very hard to traverse. So I wanted to give them another kind of attribute that would make them more interesting to fight. And not only that, as you can see in the previous clip, you can actually knock away the projectiles. But they will give you a special effect, as I'm going to show you in the next clip.
They're kind of adorable looking, the Shulkas. Kind of cute.
So now I'm inside an NCT. Double-edged sword. It's not the correct term for this particular thing, but they have more. They can be used. Yeah.
That's super cool. That's going to be super fun to encounter for sure. Okay, so let's move on to the next point, I guess.
You're happy with that, yes?
Yes.
Cool. Nathan.
Hello.
You have also been working on some kind of cool combat mechanic things, haven't you? Is that correct?
I didn't do nothing. It wasn't me.
No.
I have been.
Tell us what it is. What's the deal?
Alright. First, I may as well tackle some spoilers that were in the videos. Screenshots.
Oh, yeah.
If you just go... One moment. For professionals.
I think people probably spotted the spoilers as soon as we looked up the video.
Alright, so if we switch over to the screen, you'll see... this is halfway through the video, so whatever. The new big feature of combat is dual welding, which is a really big deal for us, technically, because it was really, really difficult to pull off, like, unbelievably. As I'm demonstrating in the video now, you can have something in your main hand, yeah, everyone knows that. You can also change your main hand to your left hand. So lefties, I've got you covered.
Nice.
The interesting thing is when you have something in both hands, like I have here. I've got torches in my left hand, and my main hand is in my right hand, so I've got the bow there. Just switch back to the screen to the video. Just keep it posted. So as you can see here, and the thing goes away, I've got a bow in my main hand, and I've got a torch in my offhand. This is kind of useless normally. What I will be able to do, if in a moment I'm going to switch over to the sword in my main hand, the right click button on my mouse, which is normally place block or use an item, is going to place the torch, which is in my offhand. And you can see on the screenshot at the bottom there, it shows what's in my offhand. So I've got 64 torches there right now. That was shown in the other video, I can't remember what you had in your offhand, but there was something.
I had bow and arrows.
Yeah, there you go. So I'll get to that in a moment though, because bow and arrow, that is changing a lot. If you resume the video. Base. Alright, there's a hotkey to swap what's in the main hand. So as you can see, I just press F, which is the default key, which whatever's in my main hand goes offhand and vice versa. So it's really easy to switch whatever you're holding in your hand. The main benefits of this don't just impact combat. If you're mining in a cave, you've got a pickaxe and torch, for example, you can light things up while you're mining. If you're fighting people in combat, you can have a potion or a golden apple in your offhand and a sword or something else in your main hand, so you can drink while you're fighting. I mean, that's really ineffective, but you can do that. We're not going to stop you from doing that. And also, there's a lot of role-playing mechanics, I guess, that could be abused there.
What if I want to be, like, super safe?
Super safe?
Yeah.
You would need some kind of shield for that, I think, wouldn't
indeed.
You?
Indeed. Yes, indeed.
I think we have a photo that could make you happy. Not a video, I'm afraid.
No. It's a Jens one. Yeah. It's called... No, not that one.
Shields!
Nice.
Yeah, these are very much still in the work in progress, so they may not be in the first 1.9 snapshot, but as you can see, the idea is that after you craft your shield, you will also be able to craft it together with a banner, to put the banner, this banner thing, on your shield, so you can really customize your look and feel.
Can I dual wield shields?
Yes.
Great.
To answer your question, you can be super safe. You can turtle by having a shield in both hands and just stay still. People can go behind you and they can hit you from behind. That will probably hurt, but yeah, come to find your covers.
Nice. Okay, cool. You mentioned some arrows earlier, some bow and arrow.
Yes, bow and arrows. If you go back to my folder, there should be arrows, I think. Please show this on the screen. So bow and arrows are changing a little bit. We've got some new arrow types. This here is spectral arrows. You can see them in my offhand there. The offhand, if you put an arrow in there, it means use this one. You don't need it in your offhand, but it's just nice to have a preference. So the spectral arrows, you shoot something and they glow. Doesn't matter where they are, they glow. Everyone sees them glow. So this could be really useful in, for example, PvP mechanic. If you're shooting someone, they're running away, you can track them for a small period of time. We're not sure what that time is, probably 10, 15 seconds. But if you get hit by one of these, you are vulnerable. You cannot hide. So those are extremely utility arrows. You're not going to use them in a regular fight. You're probably not going to use them in survival, but PvP, those are going to be extremely useful, I feel. There they are again. The next arrows...
It's a bit like wall hacks.
Yes, it's wall hacks. Legit wall hacks right here.
Yeah.
As we demonstrating that you can see them from behind blocks. You just get the outline. For players on teams, it will glow the outline of their team color. So if they're on a red team, they will see a red outline right there. The next arrow, this one is, I believe, a poison arrow. No, this one's the invisibility arrow. So you can tip arrows with a certain potion. And for example, I just turned those invisible. I don't know why you would do that, but I'm not going to stop you from doing that. This one is the poison arrow. You'll see that they just poof out of existence because they're poisoned. Obviously, there's going to be a lot of balancing required for these. I'm personally not happy with how potions are balanced, especially splash potions. I'm sure you guys have tried them. You throw a splash potion of poison on someone, and you hit yourself. Oh no. So, arrows, tipped arrows especially, need a lot of balancing because it will be extremely overpowered if you just poison someone long distance, take them down half a heart apart. And that's not fun at all. Yeah, I think that's that. The spectral arrows, I've got a nice other video to show off how you can spot if you've been hit by a spectral arrow. So, if you exit this video, and you've seen it in the other screenshot with the levitation, there should be buff bar. Oh, effects. Yeah, so switch to the video. I'm giving myself lots of effects now, and you can see them in the top right of the screen. You don't have to keep opening your inventory, you don't have to rely on particles, you can see that you've got an effect. These are sorted, so the top layer is things that are good for you, and the bottom layer is things that are bad for you. Don't get anything on the bottom there, okay? That's my advice for the game. Top is good, bottom is bad. They're also sorted left to right. The things that are made left on the screen are the ones that are expiring soon. The things on the right are expiring later. As you can see, the top effect is running out now. So it's starting to flash. The more urgent it flashes, the sooner it runs out. So, for example, with Jens' new neat levitation effect, you can time it so you can see I've just got a few seconds left. Am I going to make that jump with it?
In which bar would the levitation effect be?
That was actually a really difficult question. I decided to count it as a negative effect, just because things offensively get hit you with it. So that's the new buff bar. So as you can see, the UI has changed. We've got the buff bar at the top right, and we've got offhand at the bottom left, or bottom right if you're left-handed. So it's on the side with offhanders. So we've changed that up a bit. And I think this will help a lot, especially with effects on arrows, like tipped arrows, spectral arrows, this kind of stuff. And that's that.
That's awesome. Well, all those things sound super cool. I think that's all we've got from the Minecraft devs about new updates, but now we can talk to the Pop Edition guys. So, thanks for that.
You too.
Thank you. Daniel and Tommaso.
Hi, everyone.
How are you guys doing? So, these dudes are responsible for making Pop Edition.